Well, welcome to our Spring EcoSchools Youth Conference. Our theme is Make Change Happen, since our world can't wait for humans to keep talking about change. Yes, we will be doing more talking than action this morning, but tomorrow you can start the action. We have 8 wonderful speakers today who we know will inspire you to take your own action tomorrow. So be sure to ask them lots of questions today. Before we meet them, hang on to your hats because we've got a different kind of land acknowledgement, not the typical TDSB version, but a video produced by students in the Peel Board. We think you'll like this version a lot. Here we go.
When they are home, when they are home, when
they land acknowledgements are a starting place to change how the land is seen and talked about. They help redefine how people place themselves in relation to Indigenous peoples. In the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Treaty, we are asked to remember that on this land, we all eat from the same bowl. So now what? There's some harsh truths about injustices that have happened and are still happening in Canada, often carried out by institutions we believed in and trusted, and these truths contradict what many of us were taught. This is why we have land acknowledgements.
Take a moment to pause and acknowledge that we are on the traditional territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit Nation, the Anishinaabe, the Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat, and is now home to many other diverse First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples.
Those Peel students did such a great job on that. I just love it. We have 26 different schools and groups in today from all corners of the city. Some might be arriving at 9:15. But we appreciate all of you joining us because it means you are the folks who are serious about climate action, and we need each and every one of you. We need your enthusiasm and leadership to make the big changes our city needs. Thanks for joining. And we have a great team of people who work to support you from the Sustainability Office, of which we are a part. So many, in fact, I'll save about 15 minutes if I just introduce you to the people who are here today. Pam is our de facto leader, which makes sense as she's the instructional leader for EcoSchools and the brains of our operation. Jen is a close second and the brain trust of how things work here at the TDSB when it comes to all things EcoSchools and especially those water bottle filling stations. I'm the new guy on the block and have way more skill with technology than anything else. One day I hope to know how things work around here, but together, we do a fine job supporting you, our wonderful students and teachers, to take on meaningful climate action at your schools. The big action we've been focusing on lately is food waste and why it should never be put in the garbage. And to help explain why this is important, I'm going to get a guy named Raleigh to say a few things. He's in the States, but his message works equally well here.
If you've been to a grocery store lately, you've probably noticed that all of America's food is ominously stamped with the day that food will die. I'm talking, of course, about expiration dates. When it comes to food, expiration dates might say expires on, or best by, or used by, or even the magnificent for wholesome great taste served before date stamped below. But all of these expiration date labels have one very important thing in common. They have nothing to do with whether the food is actually expired. That's right, these so-called expiration dates on your food are not and have never been about whether your food is safe to eat. And this is not just my Andy Rooney get off my lawn opinion, it is the official position of the safety-loving dorks at both the FDA and the USDA. The date you see on packaging is usually just some guy's best guess at when you're gonna have the optimal taste experience, but the mere presence of a date on food packaging leads to 84% of consumers and 100% of grocery stores throwing away perfectly good food because a box told them to. In this case, misleading expiration dates are a major contributing factor in the United States wasting 40% of our total food supply. Yeah, 40. with a D. Of all the food that gets grown or imported in the United States, we don't eat almost 40% of it. And the vast majority of that gets trucked to a landfill where it piles up, ferments, and turns into methane. And not to get too climate changey on you, but methane has a bad habit of off into the atmosphere, where it lives the rest of its life as a greenhouse gas that traps heat 80 times more than carbon dioxide. And if that doesn't do anything for you, here's a stat. 2% of the US GDP goes to grow food that does not get eaten. Yeah, we're wasting the entire GDP of a country that goes here. Every year, the United States is growing and then wasting an entire Norway in food. And to be clear, it's not just expiration dates. Food waste is happening all over the place. And organizations like ReFed are cranking out charts and graphs that are exactly my style. There we go. Perfect. Now, obviously, I cannot see this chart, but I am editing this video, so you'll be able to see that food waste is happening on every level of the food system. We lose 8 million tons of food per year because people get afraid of expiration date labels, but we also lose millions of tons to things like harvesting issues, mistakes and malfunctions, and food being considered too ugly. Food waste is a massively complicated problem, but the easiest and fastest thing to solve is people misinterpreting the labeling on their food. Plus, it's one that you can actually have a measurable impact on. Hi, I'm Raleigh Williams. I have a belly full of milk, a head full of complaints, and a master's degree full of climate science and policy. And this is a video about how expiration dates are bull. Welcome to Climate Town.
Well, if you like what Raleigh has to say, search up his YouTube channel, Climate Town. He's funny, does lots of research, and might inspire you to action. And there's like another 20 minutes of his video on food waste that you can continue. But what is it that we are going to be doing today?
So details you need to know attending this morning's conference. This is a TDSB conference, so the code of online conduct applies to all of us. Please be respectful when using interactive apps like Mentimeter. The main room, which you're in right now, will always have EcoSchool staff for questions, to share links, any other details you might need to know. Please sign up for workshops now if you haven't already. And there is a link to the Google form in the chat, I believe. And please download the schedule with links and workshop descriptions. The link to file is also in the chat. And I'm not sure, Chris, I don't think we have our links in there yet. Now I'd like to welcome our keynote speaker, Steve S.J. Lee, who will be engaging with us this morning and inspiring us all. Steve S.J. Lee is a climate activist who has spent 15 years on sustainable development, climate change, and meaningful youth engagement as a campaigner, policy advocate, and entrepreneur. Steve was the organizing partner elected to lead the major group for children and youth, and its 26 constituencies that represent children and youth in over 120 policy processes at the United Nations. The founder of Foundation for Environmental Stewardship and its 3% Project, and SDG's Youth Training Canada, Steve is a certified fundraising executive and a Clean 16 and Clean 50 winner as Canada's leader in sustainability. Steve is scientifically trained at the University of Toronto and a follower of Jesus. Please welcome Steve S.J. Lee to lead us on our keynote this morning.
Hello. Hi, good morning. Can everyone see and hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yeah, awesome. Okay, and can people see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Beautiful. Okay. Well, hi, everyone. My name is Steve. Thanks for having me here today. What I want to talk about today is the climate crisis, but climate in the context of the future we want. And that's exactly what the world did back in 2015. 193 countries got together and they envisioned what kind of future do we want by 2030. And they came up with these 17 goals: to eradicate extreme poverty, to fight climate change, to reduce inequalities, to achieve gender equality. This is the kind of future that the world wants to have. It's a vision to create a more inclusive, fair, prosperous, and sustainable future. And there are two sets of system challenges to achieving this kind of future. And I'm going to talk about system challenge or system a lot, so pay attention to that. There are two sets of system challenges for achieving this kind of future. The first set of system challenge is the exponentially growing technologies that are coming out, like artificial intelligence, AI, Internet of Things, blockchain, nanotechnology. These are sometimes called the fourth industrial revolution. And this is something that our generation, you and I, are starting to create and we're starting to understand. So this is the first set of system challenge. And the next is climate. Climate change was created by previous generations and passed down for us to figure out. And now every generation has these two types of challenges that history presents to us. Something that we're starting to create and something that's been passed down to us for us to figure out. For our generation, it happens to be these two challenges. So let's look at what these are and how we can solve them. First, let's look at climate. Climate change is a symptom of energy imbalance on the planet. Basically, energy is moving around in places that nature doesn't naturally like to have. All the energy on planet Earth comes from the sun. That could sound crazy, but if you look at the size comparison, it makes sense. Sun is incredibly large compared to Earth. So even the tiniest amount of energy from the sun that arrives on Earth is not enough to sustain all life on Earth. So how does it work? Plants like trees are nature's energy storage. We take sunlight, plants photosynthesize, turn it into sugar. Then animals like you and me eat the plants. Then we all die at some point and go back into the soil. Then after a very, very long time, some of it becomes fossil fuel like coal, oil, or gas. So this is how planets' natural energy gets stored. And we want to keep them in there. But what humans have done in the past a couple centuries is we've learned how to dig these up as energy and use it to heat things up, to benefit us. And then we put it into atmosphere, a tiny vulnerable part of the planet. So there's nothing wrong with the energy. There's nothing wrong with using the energy. The problem is that we're moving energy from one place to another very, very fast, much faster than the planet would do on its own. So how are we doing that? We're digging up that energy and putting it into atmosphere, into the sky in many different ways, from agriculture to industrial activity, transportation, many different ways. So when we're looking at the kind of future we want, the first system challenge is how we're using energy, where we get the energy, how we place the energy after we've used it. So that's the first system challenge. The second I talked about was exponentially growing technologies like the fourth industrial revolution. I can't quite see the classes here, but I'm sure you can raise your hands and kind of try to interact here. So anyone heard of industrial revolution? You may have learned about it in history class or something. It gets defined whenever the way we make things, the way we use things completely change. We're not talking about just one area of energy or communication or transportation. When all three, energy, communication, and transportation change, that's a revolution. We've gone through three of them in history so far, where we've well entered into the fourth industrial revolution. And some of these technologies I want to share with you. First is AI, artificial intelligence. This is an example by Google's DeepMind. They made two sticks, literally two sticks, and told it to get from point A to point B. Within less than a week, the computer figured out on its own the concept of walking. That was the most naturally best way for two sticks to move from one place to another. And that's exactly how humans learn. We try different things, we make mistakes, and then we learn what to do again and what not to do again based on what worked and didn't work. Computers can make mistakes much faster than humans and remember the result of every mistake, so they can learn much more efficiently than we can. So how do you apply something like that? This is self-driving electric vehicles. This is kind of the back end of how, you know, Tesla's self-driving electric vehicles would work. They understand road signs, hand gestures, obstacles, people moving around to be able to get around. When it's applied at a larger scale, cars know exactly what car's coming, at what direction, at what speed, and don't need traffic lights. There are already towns that operate this way in different parts of the world to try it out. It moves through intersection, just like blood goes through different blood vessels in our body. Anyone here seen or used 3D printing? Some of you, many of you. Now, we're also using 4D printing, where the printed material changes shape over time based on its external environment. So for example, if you buy an IKEA chair, it could be printed flat, shipped to you, and it'll form into a chair overnight when you take it out of the box. That could be something you use at home, but it could be also in space shuttles, where a part of an engine can change its shape when it overheats. And when it goes back into normal temperature, it'll change its shape back. Then now one part can serve multiple parts. So less stuff needs to get into space, making engines smaller, which means less fuel, which means less energy, which means cost comes down for travel, and maybe airplanes too. Not only that, we can also print human organs. This is a video from 2006. They were printing kidneys, and the printed kidneys are now actually transplanted into human body, and that person has been alive for over 2 years now. So printing organs, parts of organs, blood vessels, skin parts, human organ printing has already been a thing as well. Robotics have become so advanced that Russia and other countries have been testing RoboCop Army that will stand in front of the army as a shield. So, and they have over close to 100% firing success rate. And they can also hijack vehicles on the warfield, drive it around. And you can see President Putin very happy with this technology, and that could be terrifying for some of us. Or you can use it for nicer purposes, like getting your robot to cook. It can scan your social media to see what recipes you like, your credit card statements to see what restaurants you enjoy, and send a phone notification to see if you want panini for dinner, and it'll be there when you arrive at home. Or you can get drones to use artificial intelligence to scan different landscapes, identify what kind of native species live there, plant tree pods and seeds while flying across the land. It makes reforestation efforts much more efficient and cheaper than what we're doing now. And this kind of technology in the past decade has been used all over the world, replanting and reforesting some of the areas. Or you can put it in your body directly. It's called implantable technology. It sounds like an Iron Man style future technology. This has been around since 1980s. In fact, there's a professor from University of Toronto, a Canadian, who has a chip implanted in his brain to conduct research on himself, because, you know, not that many people want to voluntarily try that on themselves. This is a macaque, a monkey. There, you see the video moving. There we go. This monkey has a chip implanted in his brain, and he's playing this Pong computer game just by thinking. He's drinking banana juice because that's what motivates him to stay there and play the game instead of going somewhere else. But yeah, this guy is just thinking, and the video, the computer game gets played. So there's so many new technologies that are coming out, and this is something you and I need to figure out. You know, just take a moment just to think about the implications. What does this mean for us? Right? All these new technologies that are coming out, I'm sure you have seen ChatGPT. I love using ChatGPT. I use it every day for everything in my life. It's great. And we can use these technologies, but there are all kinds of other things we need to think about when we're using these implantable technologies, when we're, we have a chip in our brain and it starts working directly, you can just think, what is the population of Romania? And you just know. You know, you don't need to search it. The way we do that now is we need to think it. We need to move our fingers through a keyboard to translate it into words, which get translated into electric signals. Then that gets sent into data servers, which comes back and shown as light, which comes through your eyes, and then gets translated into electric signals that your brain understands to be the population of Romania. That's a lot of steps. Now, we could just think, what's the population of Romania? And you just know, it goes electric signal to electric signal. So what's the implication of that? Who gets to have what kinds of chips? What countries would allow that? What are the legal implications? MIT University has an ethics lab around AI. They believe by year 2100, which some of us could be alive for, by 2100, there will be an apartheid in the world of the enhanced and the not enhanced. And they expect over 70% of human population by that point to have some form of enhancement, whether chip in your brain or body part or different things. What are the implications of that? If you upload your mind, your brain, to a data server with an artificial general intelligence, and you decide to not exist anymore and just exist as a data server, is that you or is that something else? Once you've uploaded, are you now two separate people or is that one person in two different entities? Who gets to decide these things? How do we even think about these things? You know, I strongly believe that climate change is not the only problem in this world. I mean, just look at this chart. There's so many issues in this world. But when we only focus on one problem, we tend to ignore other problems and create a whole bunch of other things. We need to take a look at the entire system, the way everything is working, and fix the relationships between these things. What is the relationship between myself and me? What's my relationship to myself? What's my relationship to people around me? What's my relationship to the technology, my relationship to nature, my relationship to climate, and relationships among all these things? How do we understand this is what I mean by system? How do we understand the relationships and work on these? So that's why it's really important to look at climate solutions in the much larger context of the future we want to create a more inclusive, fair, prosperous, and sustainable future. So I believe climate is not the only problem in this world. I don't even think it's the most important problem, but it is the most urgent problem. We've delayed solving climate for so long. Now, you and I have become the final generation who has the chance of solving climate. So we can't waste any more time. We have to leverage all the tools. We can't pick and choose. We've run out of time to pick and choose. Everyone has to do everything everywhere. So if we can take a couple minutes, you can talk to your friend sitting next to you in your class. What kind of skills would you need to develop or practice to create the kind of future we want? What are some skills? Not knowledge. We'll have knowledge. We'll have access to knowledge. That's not a problem. What are skills that you would need to develop and practice? And I want to really focus on skills that machines cannot do. Because stuff machines can do, we'll get machines to do it. What are skills that humans uniquely can do that you would need to develop and practice to create this kind of future? Take the next couple minutes, talk to your friend, and I'll come back. All right, so you've typed in some of the answers, and these are the kinds of skills we want to be developing: communication, listening, understanding, empathy, kindness, compassion. These are the skills that uniquely humans can do. And with the help of AI and machines, we can leverage them to be better at building relationships, deepening relationships, enriching relationships. So, for example, let's look at how we can solve the climate crisis as an example of getting rid of one of these system barriers we have to get to the future we want. This is Canadian pie chart of where our emissions are coming from. How are we putting energy into the sky through our life? Most of it comes from electricity and heating our homes. That's about half of it. So if we can figure that out, about half of climate gets solved. Transportation is 28. So 21, almost all of it is just us driving our cars from day to day. Then there's trucks, ships, trains, and other things. Then everything else from agriculture to industrial activities to garbage, et cetera, et cetera. So let's quickly run through some of these solutions. First is energy efficiency. One is LED lights. LED lights are very good at what we paid them to do, which is produce light, not produce heat. We're not putting up light bulbs to heat our homes, but most of the energy that goes into light bulb is actually being wasted in producing heat, not light. And LED lights are very effective and efficient at only doing what you paid it to do, which is make light. Same thing with electric vehicles. Over 80% of the gas you put in gets wasted on making heat and sound of the engine, not moving your car, which is what you paid the car to do. You're paying the car to move you around, not to produce heat and sound. But over 80% of the gas you put in gets wasted in doing what you didn't pay it to do. So electric vehicles, it's same thing as a car. It's just more effective form like LED. Insulation of the home, same thing. You would never turn on your AC and open all the windows. That's burning money down the chimney, but that's kind of what we do when we're not insulating our roofs or window seals. And you can see in the red, all the heat escaping in this picture. So insulating your house and windows, that's super helpful too. Or different glasses, there are new smart glasses that are coming out where windows have nanoparticles built into it. So it changes the amount of heat that it would let in while keeping the light component. You may have seen this on some of the airplanes, which they have had them for some time now. Or you can have district heating and cooling where different buildings are connected together to circulate heat. Some places need more heat, some places want more cooling, and you can move that energy around where all the buildings are connected. And in Vancouver, TELUS headquarters actually has this with all the buildings that they have in the area. Data centers also use a lot of energy, so they can connect data center with their office to nearby apartment or condo buildings. It's a really good way to connect all the buildings together using things like smart thermometers. You may have heard Internet of Things. There is now 10 times more machine sensors, smart sensors, than human beings on the planet. And that number is exponentially growing, where you can collect all the data that's connected through the internet. That's why it's Internet of Things. And they use artificial intelligence to improve energy efficiency. You can control things through your phone. It's constantly collecting data to make everything more efficient, using less energy. That's the energy efficiency component. Next is renewable energy. Let's look at wind first. If we can get the electricity used for heating our homes, this 45%, almost half, with renewable energy, you've solved half of climate. And wind installed around the world has been exponentially growing. We're getting more and more wind, while the cost is also coming down year after year after year. In Canada, we're installing more wind power across the country in every province. Alberta is leading this in Canada. We're manufacturing this in Canada. These are so big, you can't really make them elsewhere and then ship it over. Just wind alone can provide 40 times the energy humanity is using. Just even a small amount of that will power every electricity that the world is using and more. So it's no brainer. We have to be using the wind that is made just by Earth rotating around. Next is solar. The sunlight, solar installation, we have more solar panels at an exponential rate, while the cost is also exponentially coming down. It's getting cheaper and cheaper every day. There's so many places around the world that are now developing solar panels. China and India are the leaders in manufacturing solar panels. They have it virtually everywhere now, and we need to have more cheaper solar and to be able to use this using better batteries and more storage systems. Batteries get a lot of bad rep, especially with electric vehicles. That's because we're using chemical batteries. When you get to grade 11 Ontario, I think Ontario grade 11 chemistry will teach you how batteries work. And, you know, anode and anyway, so I'm not going to get into that, but chemical batteries are big. It uses a lot of minerals. It uses a lot of metal. We need to somehow have a breakthrough in getting out of chemical batteries into a different form. And hopefully in the next few years, some of you will graduate and go into school and then and contribute to new types of batteries that will be able to come out. There are so many examples of wind and solar, but I said 40 times the wind is what we can get. Solar is even more crazy. Just 1 hour of sunlight that reaches Earth is enough to provide us all the energy we need for the entire year. And we really just need to tap a tiny, tiny, tiny amount of that. Remember, at the beginning, sun is enormously larger than Earth. We just need to capture a tiny, tiny portion of that. So we can have solar panels on every roof and places that we don't need in developing countries and everywhere it's being used so that we get the sunlight, we get the wind, we get other forms of energy that's all connected through a smarter grid where electricity is being used where it's needed and moved around, gets stored through energy storage of different battery systems. This is the kind of future we want to get to. Next is sustainable consumption and production, how we make things, how we use things. And that accounts for all the other parts, agriculture and the other emissions, industrial activities. So let's look at that. Easiest bang for the buck, individual personal climate action you can take is eating more plants. Plant-rich diet is the easiest bang for the buck you can do, especially locally grown stuff. Locally grown food significantly reduces transportation and refrigeration it requires to move food around. So if you can get stuff that's grown locally within the region and consume more plants, the environmental footprint of that significantly goes down. It's not just having plant-rich diet. We can, so we don't have to miss out on cool things like bacon. There's different ways we can get our food, and the seaweed tastes like bacon. North Americans eat very few types of vegetables that humans can consume, and it's significantly lower than global average. We eat very few kinds of things. There's lots of cool plants and other things we can eat as well. Or you can grow meat. There's stem cell technology and heme protein extraction where you can grow the meat. The technology is getting advanced every day. I have gone to conferences and tried these. Every year it gets better and better and better. After COVID, I went to two conferences where I've tried these. You really cannot tell the difference. I could not tell the difference. It's getting better and better. Incredible stuff. Or insects. North Americans and Western Europeans don't like the idea of eating insects. Most of humanity eats insects. They're full of protein and micronutrients. They taste like shrimp and crabs. In fact, they're so similar in their biological composition that if you're allergic to shellfish, you're probably allergic to insects because they're so similar. As I said earlier, if you can eat more locally grown food, that helps with transportation, which means transportation. If you can use public transportation, carpooling, cycling, walking, especially living in the city, that's incredibly helpful. If you buy stuff, please buy stuff that you will use for a long time. If you buy cheap things that you use a couple of times and throw away, that stuff is so cheap that it can't be really recycled. So it goes straight into landfill. If you do throw them away, please recycle and reuse if you can. That's saving energy in the long run. Or the single-use plastic got a lot of attention as it should, and we're getting more biodegradable things and using more plant-based. There's so many options that are out there. And those who are more entrepreneurial or interested in material technology, this is a gold mine. This is a gold mine. If I had money, this is the stuff I'd be investing in. It's really interesting stuff that you can do. Last is awareness. A lot of people think that raising awareness is, you know, people like me who do this all the time, and you know, I'm the only one who should be doing it because this is my job. That's not true. I'm some random guy that you don't know who showed up here today and saying a lot of stuff. This is not what changes people's minds. What changes people's minds is because they heard something interesting from someone they trust. And trust can only happen if you already know the person, if you already have a relationship with that person. So, who are the people that you trust, that trust you? Who are the people that you already have a relationship with in your life? And those are the people that you have influence over. Those are the people that you have power over. Martin Luther King said, power is the ability to make change. And if that's power, you've got the power to make changes in these people's lives, whether friends or family or neighbors. This is how we move forward. So there are three key takeaways that I want you to remember as I do this. First is voting with your dollars, voting with your money. In the capitalistic society, which is what you and I live in today, when you spend your money, you're saying, good job, keep doing the good work. Here's the money for you to keep doing what you're doing because it's working. You beat the competition. I believe this is the best way for me to spend my money compared to all your competitors. Here's the money. And you're not just telling that company, you're telling all their other competitors, all the investors, the entire capitalistic system, that this, at the end of the day, having considered everything, is the best way. This is the future you want to keep funding. So if you don't want something in the future, don't give money to it. Don't signal to the market that this is the future you want to continue to see. You have to spend your money and invest it in it in alignment with the future we want. Same thing with investments. A lot of teachers who are here, the savings, the banks you use, the investments, pension funds, these are incredibly important ways that we can change and transform the system. So first, vote with your dollar. Great. Second is voting in elections. This is the single most important message of this entire presentation. In a democratic country like Canada, we decide together as a society what kind of future we want and how we want to create that. As soon as you turn 18, you can be voting in elections from the most local all the way to federal. The city, council, school board, municipality, provincial, federal. These are all different ways that we can create the future we want and how we get to create them. And you can start from your school. There are student councils. There is different ways elections happen that you can participate in. And every time when modern democratic history, things got done is because young people under the age of 25 voted in unexpectedly large numbers and led the social change. That's what happened in UK and France with abolitionist slavery. Young people were the ones who drove that change by stop drinking tea and sugar, and that made all the difference. Same thing with the suffrage movement for women's right to vote. Same thing with civil rights in the US, anti-apartheid in South Africa. Every time it's because young people like you and me who actually went to the polling booths and said, this is not the future we want. We want a different future, and directly shaped it. If you don't get a say, if we don't vote. We have to be voting. We have to participate. Every vote counts. And talking about it and participating in it makes a huge, huge difference. That's literally the system we've designed and the society we live in. Vote with your dollars and vote in elections. So I hope this presentation was helpful for you to think about how we can create a more inclusive, fair, prosperous, and sustainable future, and what kind of skills you can develop and practice to create that kind of future. Thank you so much.
Great. Thanks, Steve. Jen, I'll just take over just so we can get folks into their rooms. Steve, I love that you really gave us a picture of the innovation that's in front of us. That's really amazing. And the other part that I liked that perhaps will keep me thinking is how I can use those human skills like empathy and compassion and relationship building to make the world a better place. And so I think having all the systems work together and working on the relationships is my message that I'm going to take away. So thank you so much. I'm going to have Chris pop up the workshops as folks are coming in now as they can. Miriam is going to be presenting twice. And so she's unfortunately not able for the first session. So if you were able to sign up in advance and you want to learn, is recycling worth it? I recommend joining her second session. And so what I've done is I've put in the chat a downloadable PDF of all the links and the speakers that have got their rooms ready. And so that you can download that document or go back to your, I guess, the Google form that I sent and get the links. But I will, again, I'll put that downloadable document so you can get that and all the links are on there. I'll be staying in the main room. So if you have any questions, and also session B, understanding Indigenous relationship to water, will also be in this room. And so we, again, so glad that you've come in, that you're here, and we encourage you to head out to session one. We won't be seeing you again until after session two. So Chris, if you want to show session two, there it is. Again, everything's on the conference schedule. Download that document that's in the chat. All right. Thanks again, Steve. And so we're on to workshop one,